You have seen this since the title of my presentation, and it's a pleasure to be here and share this with you. Well, this is the outline of the presentation. I will give a brief introduction about collateral processing, and then I will talk more specifically about aqueous processing of functional ceramics and non-stoichiometric dissolution reactions that they usually undergo in water, and the charge compensation and the pH, let's say, changes that happen as a consequence of this. And I also will show you how to prepare micro components by epoxy gel casting. Well, as you know, all powders are more or less agglomerated, and we need to destroy the agglomerates when we want to process the powders properly in order to avoid the big pores, the inter-agglomerated pores, and some of intra-agglomerate pores. So we need to invest efforts in deagglomeration and dispersion. And when you put powders in liquid, there is always some, like water, for example, some dissociation of surface groups, and they are pH dependent. At low pH, the surface becomes enriched in hydrogen ions, so positively charged, while at high pH, the OH groups are predominate, so conferring a negative charge on the surface. But there are other surface charge development mechanisms, such as adsorption of dissolved species from the solution that also bring charge on the surface, or a non-stoichiometric dissolution that happens with several crystals like silver iodide, silver chloride, and the materials that we are going to discuss in this presentation. Another mechanism is the lattice isomorphic substitutions. For example, if you replace silicium in the network of kaolin by an aluminium, it is equivalent to add a negative charge. Well, so the surface charge that develops at the surface at the surface of the particles, they are pH dependent, as I have said. And there is a given pH at which there is no net charge at the surface. This pH is known an isoelectric point or point of zero charge. And if we go to to more acidic conditions, we will have positive charges. And the opposite, if you go to alkaline, more alkaline conditions, you will charge negatively the surface. Well, the isoelectric point and point of zero charge, they coincide in the absence of specific adsorption. But if specific adsorption occurs, then everything changes. I will show later. So the surface charge determines surface charge and thermal motion determines a certain distribution of ionic species around the particle. And there is an inner part. It forms an electrical double layer with an inner part, which is the stem layer, and the diffuse layer in the outer part. And there is a notional boundary within which the particle acts as a single entity, and the potential at this boundary is known as zeta potential. We are going to talk about zeta potential in this presentation. Well, this is, imagine that we have a powder with a given isoelectric point. If cationic species are adsorbed, the electrophoresis curve will be shifted to the right, while in the presence of specific adsorption of anions, it will be shift to the opposite direction, to the left. So we can take profit of this to select a given pH, play with dispersants to promote these shifts, and select the right pH range for the processing. And as you know, the colloidal stability, it depends on the balance between the attractive forces of van der Waals and the repulsive forces of the electrical double layer. And the total force or total energy as this kind of, let's say, behavior with a barrier that opposes particles to approach each other. If they have kinetic energy, they might overcome the energy barrier and follow in a primary minimum. But usually, when we have good dispersion conditions, we have something like that with a secondary minimum where they are weakly flocculated and can be easily redispersed. Besides the van der Waal forces and the electrostatic forces, we might have other forces that also play roles. I will not discuss all of them, just the forces that derive from the adsorption of polymeric species at the surface that promote static interactions. Well, so we have agglomerated powders. We need to disperse them. There are different, we need to destroy the agglomerates and disperse the particles. Different options in terms of the stabilization mechanisms, electrostatic stabilization, which is based essentially on the surface charge and the repulsions promoted by this surface charges. Static stabilization is the mechanism that derives from the adsorption of polymeric species. These polymeric species are designed to not strongly adsorb to the surface. They just adsorb through small segments and form laces and tails that extend to the solution. And this chain doesn't like much each other, so they are not good neighbors, I would say. And when the particles with this configuration approach, they feel start feeling a certain repulsion, which is, let's say, the static stabilization mechanism working. We can also have a mixture of electrostatic and static in a single one, which is known as electrostatic stabilization, in which we have polyelectrolyte chains that with groups that ionize and bring charges to the surface. So the other mechanisms we are not going to discuss in this presentation. Well, I will show you some results about barium titanate, barium strontium titanate, which is a solid solution, and also about the more complex material is barium zirconate titanate, barium calcium titanate. This material has been, let's say, investigated, discovered in Japan some years ago. And the intent is to replace the PZT that contain lead. So we are talking about lead-free materials. Well, a few years ago, we're dealing with the barium titanate, and we realized that the literature contained some wrong concepts about the dispersion of and stability of barium titanate powders in water. So the beliefs were that barium carbonate brings instability to barium titanate suspensions. Dispersants act as passivating agents, preventing, let's say, hydrolysis. And barium carbonate was the source of the barium ions in solution, and upon aging, pH increases. Well, it is exactly the opposite. So I can assure you that valium carbonate facilitates dispersion. The dispersants, they foster dissolution. So and valiant titanate is the main source of valium ions, and upon aging, the pH with valium carbonate decreases, not increases. So this is an insightful paper that sheds light over this pre-existing wrong concepts. This plot shows the evolution of pH of suspensions of valium carbonate in water and in water with the added dispersant. What we can see is that the pH decreases and along the time, this is during about 1 week, and it reaches an equilibrium values which coincide with the pH of seawater. This is an interesting aspect. And this plot shows that after 30 minutes, the valium concentration in liquids after 30 minutes, 1 week in water, and what happens also in the solution of the dispersant. So a small increase is here after 1 week, but in the presence of the dispersant, the dissolution is must more extensive dissolution occurs. And so means that the dispersants are not passivating agents at all. And this plots compare what happens with barium carbonate, dissolution of barium from barium carbonate and from barium titanate. So higher concentrations of barium come always from barium titanate. So barium titanate is the main source of barium ions in solution. And why dispersant stimulates dissolution? Well, this has to do with the formation of dispersant complex with barium. To prove this, we add different concentrations of barium titanate to a solution of 1 gram per liter of dispersant. And what happened was that precipitates formed for the higher concentrations of barium nitrate. So this is particularly visible here in the highest concentration. And this are, let's say, complexes of barium, which can be divalent complexes. I mean, more bidentate complexes or monodentate complexes in the other situations. And the formation of this dispersant complex were also proved by FTIR. This is the spectrum of the dispersant. There are strong peaks, intense peaks here that disappear after combination, after formation of the complexes. While the peaks in this region, they become stronger. We have here the after 30 minutes, after 1 week, and this corresponds to the precipitate. So more complex is formed, more intenser these peaks become. So, and this plot compares the what we have seen before about the pH evolution for barium carbonate in water and in the presence of dispersant with that of barium titanate, also in the presence of dispersant, and also in these cases with some added barium carbonate, 5%, 2%. What we can see for barium titanate is that the pH always increases. There is a sudden increase at the beginning, always increases. This is in the presence of dispersant. This is in water. And the increasing trend also exists for the 2% carbohydrate, but the pH values are always a little bit lower. But when we increase the amount of volume carbonate to 5%, the pH values are much lower. So this means that barium carbonate is helping in the dispersion, not the opposite. So why pH increases? The pH increase has to do with the non-stoichiometric dissolution or incongruent dissolution, if you want. For example, for each divalent ion that goes to the solution, two hydrogen ions have to enter into the structure for charge compensation. And this hydrogen ions create an imbalance in the solution. And so the relative concentration of OH groups increase, and accordingly, the pH increases. And the easiness how the different ions are leached, it depends on the ionic field strength, is a parameter defined in this way. And the values for barium, strontium, and titanium ions are here. So the lower values for barium explains why barium is preferentially dissolved and exists in the solution higher concentrations. This plot compares also the rheological behavior of suspension of barium carbonate. We can achieve 60 volume percent solids very easily, and the curves are shear thinning and smooth. For barium titanate, we have difficulties in concentrating. For example, this is for 50, with the maximum achievable. But even so, we have shear thinning up to a given shear rate. Then there is a shear-induced flocculation, and there is a jump. So the viscosity is too high for the suspension to be properly handled. Well, but another interesting feature is here. This is for 45 volume percent barium titanate. And this is with added 2% barium carbonate. So the curve is below. And the curve is even for 5% barium carbonate, the curve is even below. So proving again that barium carbonate is helping in dispersing barium titanate. Well, to prevent hydrolysis of this kind of materials, functional materials, we have used the same strategy that we have already that proved to be effective for other water sensitive materials like aluminum nitride, aluminum magnesium spinel. Treating the surface of these powders with aluminum hydrogen or phosphate. So it was very effective. We used the same in this powders, and the results show that this curves are for the surface treated powders. The pH does not change along the time. This is with and without dispersant. But for the non-treated powders, the pH increases. There is a fast increase at the beginning, followed by let's say linear increase, while in absence of dispersant, that is, the pH is too high, so it tends to an equilibrium, but at high values as expected. So the ionic species leached to the solution are here, so they are much higher for the non-treated powders as expected. And this plot shows the X-ray diffraction for the non-treated powders after 1 week of aging. We have impurity phases that derive from the hydrolysis. This phase is identified. While for the others, they kept, let's say, the same, with the same as the original powder. This is the electrophoretic curves. For both powders, non-treated and surface treated, they behave more or less the same in the presence of dispersant. The surface treated one shows a curve deviated to the right, means that the surface the aluminium hydrogen phosphate has a cationic character relatively to the chemistry of the powder surface. Well, the barium strontium titanate, we could obtain concentrated suspensions with a good fluidity, let's say, shear thinning, smooth curves, no special problems with this material. But for the, BZT, VCT material, after aging for 1 week, the non-treated, surface treated powder and has undergone hydrolysis and the impurity phases appear, while again, the surface treated powders kept the same spectra as the original powder. So surface treatment is very effective in preventing hydrolysis. And this plot shows that when we add different amounts of dispersant, there is a optimal amount, 0.58%, that we used after that. And the zeta potential curves also indicates that the surface treated powder is easily to disperse than the non-treated powder. So surface treatment also helps in the dispersion of the powders. And so we try to maximize the solid loading, and we could reach 60% volume with this material. So very easily, more than 60 is not possible. And the achieving very high solid loading is very important, especially if we want to replace or find, let's say, an alternative to micro machining. So our aim was to use a colloidal approach to fabricate micro components. And so the requirements for micro casting are here. We need to have suitable molds. We have to have low viscosity suspensions with high solid loadings. Then we also need to homogeneous cast the molds. And the suspension should be able to set, self-set inside the mold. And for this, we use epoxy gel casting that was the only one that revealed to be effective for this, because we have tried other like traditional gel casting and it didn't work because the grain strength is not enough to overcome the molding shear stresses undergone by the components. So epoxy gel casting, this is the schematic, which involves ceramic powder deagglomeration, dispersing, adding an epoxy resin. Then after obtaining a homogeneous slurry, we can add a mine-based hardener that promotes gelation, and then we can unmold and sinter. This is we use the polyimethyl siloxane molds, and the molds, the casting was assisted by vacuum to remove the air bubbles and obtain a completely cast part. Then this the suspension is self-set by epoxy gel casting, and later can be unmolded. And well, how much resin we need to do this? Well, the processing, the easiness of processing depends on the added amount of resin. We can see that when you increase the amount of resin, the gelation times decreases. Gelation time is defined by the crossover point between G prime and G double prime. I mean, elastic models and the viscose models or the suspensions. And so we can play with the amount of resin to adjust the gelation time if you want. We usually used with 15 volume percent. And this plot shows that adding epoxy resin also helps in the dispersion. So the zeta potential is more negative, is higher with this negative sign, of course, when we have epoxy resin. And with this epoxy gel casting, we could consolidate several kinds of pillars and micro components. These are some examples. High aspect ratio pillars. These are other micro components, sorry for this. Other microstructure that can be obtained, or micro components that can be easily obtained by epoxy gel casting. Well, the properties of the sintered bodies, they depend, of course, on the microstructure, and they were sintered at different temperatures. There are the maximum density was obtained in this case at 13 and degrees C. And this, of course, these details are reflected in the final properties. The same happens with for the BCT composition. So the final properties depend on the quality of the processing and depend on the final microstructure. So I think I'm reaching the end of the, and I would like to conclude saying that aqueous processing of water sensitive powders like barium titanate, barium strontium titanate, and BZT, BCT compositions requires a previous surface treatment against hydrolysis. Polyelectrolyte anions act as monodentate or bidentate clades and enhance the solution. Epoxy gel casting is an interesting cost-effective technique for fabricating microcomponents with complex shapes. And the functional properties depend mostly on the homogeneity of the and the, of the final microstructure, or in a word, depends on the quality of the overall processing. So I would like to thank all my collaborators and thank you for your attention. Thank you very much.